sometimes you have to go in the kitchen and actually have a coat on to cook.
It's been so cold that I could see my breath in my room.
Yeah, the whole house is coughing. All my children coughing.
The kitchen, the damp and the mould blame on us.
I try and stay out as long as possible just so we're not facing the cold.
Giving us that compensation that is a joke.
But we have received a letter saying that all the works will be done within months. And now 1 year has passed and another year is coming. There is no certainty. We don't know.
But it seems to me they're not listening.
I'll start at the beginning because Vicky actually asked what I've always dreamt of being asked to speak about, which is, what problems are you facing? Which is great, because you get all these speeches about what's wrong with the world and things that we know anyway, right? And people talk about that and not about how they actually organize. And if people do talk about they organize, not here, because Vicky's asked all of us the same question, I'm sure. But usually people just talk about the successes and for obvious reasons don't want to go into what all the problems are, because it's discouraging. You could lose your funding if you have any. You know, whatever, but it's very hard to do that. So I'm going to tell the story of Fuel Poverty Action, which does have successes, but also has a lot of problems. We started with Climate Camp. You want to show the one slide? I asked my colleague back from London to show an iconic Climate Camp picture, and I thought I'd see a mass of tents and some scaffolding poles where people climb on to prevent anybody going into the site. These are direct action tools. And for those of you who don't remember, Climate Camp was mostly young people terrified about what the future holds in terms of the climate, because, you know, there's no housing if we don't have climate works. Organizing outside the established organizing structures, organizing on the basis of direct action. So we had these mass camps and we'd go off from them to do actions which intended to actually stop work on fossil fuels. There was actually a principle in Climate Camp, no lobbying. We didn't want to waste our time, as we saw it, talking to MPs and the rest. We were going to take action straight on. And it led to a lot of arrests and it was actually quite effective. In 2011, we thought it was coming to an end. In fact, it just got reconstituted almost immediately as Reclaim the Power, which some of you may have heard of. But we thought it was coming to an end, and some of us decided to start an organization that would focus not only on the survival of the planet, but immediate survival. And the two were always being played off against each other. Like, if you're green, you can't be concerned about the bread on the table, and that, you know, the climate's a middle class issue, right, which can't possibly concern working class people. And we said, you don't have to choose. We don't have to choose between dying from one thing or dying from another. We can have heating that is affordable and sustainable. And the same companies that are digging up the fossil fuels and burning them are also starving their customers who can't afford to eat because they're too busy paying the bills. And that the people who are making the biggest fight, in fact, against these companies, the big six and the rest of them, were actually the customers, you know, all fighting about their bills all over the country, but disempowered in one way or another. And we started organizing with pensioners, with people with disabilities, DPAC particularly, but other disability groups, asylum seekers, single mothers, and other people on the front line. And we launched, we did a mini guide, Your Rights in Relation to Energy Companies, to help people with these fights. We're just about to publish the second edition. You're the first people besides me ever to see this. We're launching it on Thursday next week with a platform of people from from DPAC, from the National Pensioners Convention and Lambeth Pensioners Action Group, a member of All African Women's Group who came to our meetings and got enough information to confront her landlord and get a boiler fixed, and Paul Nicholson, who's a poverty campaigner, Taxpayers Against Poverty, that some of you probably know. That is the kind of platform that we've always had, because one of our functions, we're in a field, fuel poverty, which has a lot of lobbyists, right? A lot of charities, and one of our purposes has been to give a platform to people who are actually on the sharp edge with fuel poverty. We do that through the media, and we also do it in actions. And we invented a kind of what we call fluffy direct action method, which is the warm-up. And it's not very arrestable, but it consists of a whole crowd of us saying that if we can't afford to heat your own home, you have a right to go into any public building and make yourself comfortable there. And we do go in, and we've gone into shopping centers, and we hold a speak out where people actually tell the truth about their experience. We've done it in shopping centers, we've done it in a library, Brixton Library. We've done it, Occupy London did one in a bank, and we did one in the House of Commons, in the lobby of the House of Commons, and got chucked out eventually, but had a good time, right, in between. That's the kind of organizing. I think there's a couple of, we've kept up like the pressure on prices and profits, because that's a kind of a core thing for fuel poverty action. And empowering people to confront their own. That's a climate camp one that you did. And then, protest. blocking roads and that kind of thing on prices and profits. But it's very hard to organize on fuel poverty generally, because people are very dispersed. Everybody's with different companies, and you don't have a group of people can that easily organize together, until people started coming to us about problems with district heating, which I don't know if people here probably have come across it, but it's like central heating for a whole building, a whole tower block or whatever, or for a whole estate, or sometimes for an even bigger area, that there's a central power station and then the hot water is piped in to people's homes. And it's a system that can work well, and does in parts of Europe, and some places here. But generally here it doesn't, because it's done on the basis of PFI or some equivalent. Stuart there knows a lot more about that than I do. And it ends up leaving people with constant outages. You never know whether you're going to have heat or hot water. And astronomical bills, because it's just not done efficiently or well. And the thing about it is that because people all have the same company in the same area, the TRAs are able to organize on this and have been doing that. We first got involved with, there was the second place we got involved with on it was Myatt's Field South Estate in Lambeth, where they were actually fighting to keep a communal heating system. From that we got in touch with Myatt's Field North next door, where they had one, which was run by E.ON, and was appalling. And we thought, okay, we can get this sorted. And I basically, little strategizing meeting in FPA, we said, okay, we have them over a barrel, because this is something that the government wants to roll out on a massive scale nationally. They're planning to roll it out, but it's completely dependent on public support, because leaseholders, among others, have to buy the buildings in estates that have district heating. So if it gets a bad rep, it's going to be like wind farms or something. If it gets a bad rep, then the whole project is not going to be profitable after all. So we've got some clout here, and I thought we could win. And we worked for a couple of years with the people on Myatt's Field North Estate, they fought tooth and nail, and we fought tooth and nail, and we went. We managed to get in to see Bayes. Everybody knows Bayes? We managed to get into CBays and had like a 2-hour meeting with them, or even more, maybe 3 hours, where the residents just gave them hell about the state of the heating system. And they're the ones who are pushing it nationally, right? And then we had a meeting with E.ON, who ran the system, which Stuart was at, and confronted them, again, loads of residents, confronted them with what the reality was. And then we sort of went to the heat trust, we gate-crashed all sorts of the national promotional meetings, that, you know, the celebrations and the rest of it, and kept saying, you know, this is what's wrong, this is what's wrong. But the problems have been, first of all, the work is enormous, and the people in the TRAs, after working on this for some years, got tired at Myersfield North, you know, got burnt out, and the work's unpaid, of course, and not supported, and not respected. And then there's the divisions, which I'm sure everybody here is familiar with, on especially the new estates, which are built with council tenants on the one hand, but also a lot of leaseholders on the other. And there's a lot of mutual distrust, because the leaseholders, as one council tenant put it, looks at us like something that you scrape off the bottom of your shoe. The council tenants, on the other hand, look at the leaseholders as like these rich people who don't have a problem in the world, whereas in fact a lot of leaseholders are also going cold because they can't heat their homes and they're subject to the same outages. And they also have slightly different positions in relation to different district heating because they have different contracts and different bills. So, you know, the seeds of division are well sown. And, it's hard to maintain the fight. And what happened in Myersfield, for instance, was that E.ON basically outlasted us. They were heard to say early on, okay, we'll wait, they'll get tired, right? And we didn't get tired for a long time, but in the end we did. We did win some things there. It's not nearly as bad as it was. And on a larger scale, we actually had bigger victories, because we have been told that because of the fight that we made here and the report that we wrote about Myersfield North, they're not actually trying the same kind of things that they tried there in other places, and the district heating system's generally improving. And I went to a meeting on Broadwater Farm in North London, which people may know, it's a kind of famous estate, right? And they're getting district heating put in there, and we managed to get somebody who's in the district heating business, who we trust, to come and help me confront them and make sure that it's not going to be screwed up like the Lambeth one was. So, you know, there are gains, but it's a bit of a harder battle than I anticipated, given what cards we held in our hands. Okay, so then into this scenario comes Grenfell. And in the midst of all the heartbreak and devastation, I think we all know that we've all gained a lot of energy and courage from the people who've been on the front line there. The people in that community who, even before the fire, were actually trying to get change and accountability in UK housing. For Fuel Poverty Action, how we come into it is that we're trying to get justice and protection for people in other tower blocks. And as you can see, there's problems for people who have the cladding still on, who are having to put their kids to bed in a building that could go up in flames, and for people who've had the cladding taken off, who are freezing. And, you know, it's really brought home the importance of insulation, because it's not only cold, but with the cold you get condensation, because there's not enough of a barrier. You get condensation, you get damp, you get mold. And the homes now are nowhere near decent home standards, nowhere near habitable, you know, what's legally required. And people are just expected to put up with it. And of course, you know, like fire, cold does kill. You know, there were 11,000 deaths last winter from the winter before last. That last winter was colder, right? But the year before there were 11,000 deaths because people couldn't afford to heat their homes. And we want one of the demands of the manifesto to be not only homes, but warm homes, well-insulated homes. So FPA, Fuel Poverty Action, decided that we need to get real action on this. We've had government promises, you know, we'll keep our people safe and so on. Oh, yeah, we didn't move even to the Myatt's Field.
No, I didn't.
Okay, sorry, Myatt's Field slide. Okay, this is before we came on the scene, right? That's the residents at Myatt's Field. And they've been organizing for years, right? So anyway, we decided we had to get re-election on the cladding issue after the government promises. And we went to two estates, the ones that were nearest to us, Chalcott's estate in Camden and Granville estate in Barnet. And I have to say at this point, fuel poverty action is extremely small. There are about a dozen active members, but most of them are not very active. We have no funding, no staff, no office, no academic connections. And I think like a lot of groups here, you know, we're very dependent on each other. You know, those of us who don't have those assets are very dependent on each other to actually achieve something. We did get, last year, we got some money from Vivian Westwood, and we decided to use that for teamwork sessions rather than employing somebody for a very short term, which was all we could have afforded. Every Thursday, there's a team group of us who get together, but it's very depleted because the young folk keep getting full-time jobs. And we're kind of left with me, and I'm a pensioner, but there's only 24 hours in a day. And I'm not very good at web work, and I'm not good at all at social media. So I have severe shortcomings. And what we want to do is to mount what is potentially a very big and effective campaign, on the one hand, for immediate cladding now, and on the other hand, for protection for people in the meantime, because getting real, it doesn't happen instantly. We want it to, we're pressing for it to, but it doesn't. And in the meantime, the kids are getting sick. And we want for, what we did first was actually go to the estates and find out what they were demanding. And what they were demanding was, first of all, compensation for the extra bills that they're paying. And that varies from one place to another. And they're short of information. Like, you know, the Granville Road people didn't know that the Chalcott's people were actually getting full payment of the difference between the bills last year and the bills with the cladding off. Granville Road people were being offered £15 a week, which sounds like a lot, but if you're having to heat your house 24 hours a day, it's not a lot. You know, people have to have that information. So compensation for the costs was one thing, but also damp treatments, you know, treatment for the mold, space heaters that you shouldn't have to buy yourself and pay the electricity for. We're asking for gym membership, free gym membership, and access to swimming pools so that even if your home isn't warm, you know, your body can be. The exercise is also important. What we've done is we've called this campaign SKIN, which is Safe Cladding and Insulation Now. We're fighting for those two wings at the same time, for protection for the residents from cold and protection from fire. And we're saying that the residents shouldn't be the ones who are having to pay for the fire wardens, you know, going around their houses to watch for a fire. They shouldn't be the ones who are having to pay the extra costs or the health costs of cold homes in the meantime. Because they're not the ones who are responsible for running down the regulations and the inspection regimes and the rest of it in the first place. But they're the ones who are actually picking up the tab. And what we did first was we held a public meeting called Dying from Fire, Dying from Cold. And it was about cladding and insulation. And the insulation was critical to it because one effect of the fire is like the facades come off. Literally, the facades come off. And what you discover when the facade comes off the buildings is that the insulation there is not just flammable. A lot of it's not there in the first place. It's missing. You know, they've put it around the edges where somebody might see, and then the rest of it's gone, ain't there. You know, without it, homes are not warm, and they're also not sustainable, you know, in terms of energy efficiency and climate. You know, it's absolutely critical. But what's also missing is, like, the fire stops. And, you know, there's structural defects, there's windows, they've at Chalcott's estate in Camden, you know, they've discovered now, okay, the windows aren't right, you know, they're not safe either, so they're all having to be redone. But this tallied absolutely with our experience on working on district heating, which was that these new built estates that are supposed to be so great and look so modern and clean and the rest of it, you know, nobody's watched as they were being built. You know, the inspectors, as we've heard earlier, you know, are all taken away. And as a result, when the residents get hold of a thermal imaging camera, when they actually take pictures of the estates that they're on, it turns out they're heating the streets. And one housing association who's running such an estate actually told them, you're heating the street, you know, when he saw the thermal images. So our plan was to bring together people from that estate, in fact, with people from Grenfell. And unfortunately, exhaustion set in, and the speaker that we had from the estate, which is heating the street, chose that moment to burn out and has dropped out of the movement completely for the moment. But the meeting was still a fantastic exchange with residents, politicians, architects, and builders. And the builders are quite key, actually. They know what really works. And it was an exchange where one sort of crucial contribution was from Ish, who I thought was going to be able to come today from the Grenfell community. He's coming tomorrow, right?
I think so, we're not sure.
Right. Anyway, he made the film, Failed by the State, which is fantastic. I hope everybody's watched it. And he said at our meeting, he said, I know it sounds funny, but this is our chance. You know, if we can't get change now, when can we get it? And from that, FPA decided to basically throw everything into this. And we made that video, which I'd like feedback on, by the way. We made the video. We made a petition that the video leads on to. The petition bombed. We've got 200 signatures, right? We released it on the first day of the heat wave, the first heat wave. And I don't think anybody was in the mood for caring about being cold, and it just never flew. But we've since done a letter to the Secretary of State. Do you want to bring that one up, if you can? A letter to the Secretary of State with the demands, which is like 10 demands. And that has had fantastic support. It's an open letter, and we're asking people to sign it. People from the movement we went to first of all, and we're now going to politicians, councils and housing associations, because, like, you know, we're asking for central government funding, and we think a lot of councils, while they're partly responsible, also have been starved of funding, and central government should be funding this. Housing associations and trade unions. We're going to a lot of the people that we said we never would lobby, and asking them to sign it as well. But we're asking people, particularly people from the movement here, to not only sign it, but promote it. Because basically, FPA can't do this alone. And we did have a discussion, like, should we do this, or is it too big for us? And we thought, ideally, what we'd do is actually not do it ourselves, but start a coalition and get lots of groups to be, you know, on an equal basis. And then we'd have all their resources as well. But the timing was short, and we didn't actually have the resources to start a coalition, which is quite a big enterprise in itself, and we decided to just go for it. And I hope it doesn't bomb like the petition. You know, I hope it does work, because we do really have to get the cladding, and we do have to get protective measures as well. You asked us to speak about our limitations, and the big one is resources. We are hoping for trade union support, and we want to go national, and that's a reason why I came up here, because we're very London-based. And basically, unless other organizations join SKIN, we are not going to get very far on a national level. And that means we probably won't get very far in London either, in fact. So that's what we're hoping for, that other people will also use your connections and your expertise and speak in your own name on the issue, you know, not just through us. The 11th of June is a big date for us, because it's just before the Grenfell anniversary, and we're hoping to hand in the letter to the Secretary of State. And then we've got, in July, we're planning to do more work on lobbying Parliament and reach out to estates as far as possible around the country and try to raise some money. In the autumn, we're planning to do warm-ups in local areas where local authorities are not giving residents the support that they need, maybe occupying some town halls and so on. So I'll leave it there.
Excellent. Thank you very much.